taking time. So there are a lot of questions for you. Maybe by the time they are winding up, a lot of interest which the talk has generated. So there were, maybe we can have one question by the time they are loading up with the talk. So the question was that there are politicians and administrators, politicians in the public atmosphere and administrators in the hospital who actually take decisions for any COVID-related policies, and doctors and nurses are the last people to have their word. So is there any organization which can actually look into it so that...
Phone again.
Editorial that I mentioned, they are not even asking senior administrators of hospitals who are working in hospital to take decisions, because they feel it's the frontline worker who is actually working in the emergency, who's working in the frontline, take their opinions as to what problems they are facing. The IMA has actually taken it up in a very big way. The IMA president, Dr. Rajan Sharma, has always been emphasizing that what is missing in this decision making is the doctor actually somewhere. And somehow the policy...
We should start screen share.
Okay.
Start screen share. Share.
Hello, you were able to see my slides?
Yes.
Yes, sir, we can see your slides currently.
Yeah, excellent. Yeah, thank you. Thanks for giving me an opportunity to talk on this virtual meeting. I saw Dr. Sarasendra sir wearing a PPE. I'll be talking more about our indigenous way of doing things in India. So it's about cath lab activation in COVID era Indian scenario. When and how? Elective procedures like PCA for a stable coronary disease, endovascular interventions for iliofemoral disease, for claudication, and PFO closure, all these kind of procedures can be postponed. And in STEMI patients, fibrinolytic therapy should be considered in most of the patients who are stable. And in case if primary PCA is considered with active COVID, the person should wear PPE. And use of powered air purifying respirator, PAPR system, which we used previously, is another good thing which can give you offer a good protection. And in STEMI patients, most of the time you have enough time to do diagnostic testing for COVID. And once you have revascularized, it's better to discharge them early so that in case they become positive, they should not spread the disease to other patients. In patients who require intubation and suctioning and/or CPR, intubation should be done in the ICU itself and not in the cath lab. And use of HEPA filters between the tube and bag when bagging of patient has already been suggested. And all personnel should be skilled in donning and doffing of this PPE. And in some situations, PAPR system may be needed. Patient with suspected COVID undergoing procedure should wear a surgical mask so that the spread is not there. So, with the increasing prevalence of COVID in the society, the chance of operating either angioplasty or even surgery on these patients, either are elective or emergency, is very high. N95 respirators are good, but they cause exhaustion of the operator. The exhaustion of the operator definitely will reflect in the operative results. When you do a complex angioplasty wearing a N95 mask or into respirator for 2 to 3 hours, obviously that will reflect in the results also. So we have another additional better system called the PAPR, that is powered air purifying respirator, which has got a battery operated motor, and it has got a filter, and it's a battery operated motor which will pump air into through this tube, and it comes to the hood, and there's a positive pressure in front of your face, so you feel comfortable while doing a procedure. And this is what has been used the world over, better than PPE and other things. This is how it looks like when you put on a hood and this tube, you wear this powered PAPR in the hip, and then through that tube air comes and it is delivered above your head onto into the face. But the equipment is a bit costly, and the motor and battery are bulky, and the battery needs recharging. It works for 3-4 hours, but it needs suddenly it might go. So it needs recharging. And the most important problem which we faced initially was that equipments need cleaning after every case. It has to be wiped with alcohol and all that, and it is not possible per day. We do around 6-7 cases. You can't do it for every case, but it offers great mobility. As far as the hood is concerned, it is costly and imported. And the problem is that it is not autoclavable or sterilizable. So you feel that you are not sterile after 2 or 3 days. You don't feel like wearing it. And in case if you are doing surgery, our surgeons also have adopted, anesthetists also have adopted it. But they also felt that it is they were not very comfortable. They were worried about contamination of the operative field. So sterility is questionable. It has to be bleached or alcohol swipe, and alcohol swiping is not easy. Every part of it can't be swiping, but it has got a perfect finish. Probably it's an excellent product for industry. So we have come out with our own technique, like Tanjavur air barrier technique. I am from Tanjavur, so I named it like that. So after learning from PAPR, we have started using this. First thing what we have done is, I told you that it was difficult to clean the equipment. So we done away with the equipment. So we have just taken a supply from the hospital air, medical air, and through the tube we have connected a HEPA filter. HEPA filter, you know, all of us have been knowing it for years together, and it has been one of the very safest filter which we have been using in ventilated patients, and we are well versed with that HEPA filter. We connected a HEPA filter, and it has been told that it gives 99.97% protection against COVID. So we have connected a HEPA filter and then started using without a motor, and it was working very well. And I just heard about medical air, which is available in our hospital. And medical air is one of the safest air supply in the world, because we have got a powered filter and air dryer. It filters pollen, petrol, grease, everything. And every hourly they are doing a check, because it's controlled by medical authorities, and it is one of the best air. And third party also examines that every week or so. They give a certification. So that is the best air you can breathe. So we have started using medical air. We have taken one supply from the hospital air and connected to a panel. Which has got 3 or 4 connectors, and from that we have taken 3 tubes, and we have started manufacturing our own hood. Our hospital tailor stitched a similar hood, and then to not only myself, my associate, my technician, my nurse, everybody, we gave a hood, and we have started doing angioplasty. So this is we have done around 6 angioplasty so far using this. And in addition to the hood and the HEPA filter, we also used the N95 mask inside, so that it gives you an additional protection, and it gives protection to the patient on the operating field. When you expel air, and it might infect the operating field. Not for us, actually. In case if surgeon uses it, then it gives additional protection. So to compare the PAPR and our technique, Tanjavur air barrier technique, the equipment is costly, and most of it motor driven, it's bulky, and battery needs recharging, and equipment needs cleaning in every case, but it offers great mobility. But it uses filtered air from cath lab. But our technique is already existing infrastructure. Nothing has been bought. Everything in India, everything is already available. Only tube connection we are given, then nothing else. And it works continuously. Hours together you can operate. There is no worry of battery being discharged, and there is no equipment. And it offers only limited mobility because it's tube connected, but that's enough in a theater or a cath lab setup, and uses medical air from compressed air. That is the best thing, that because it's a very good quality air. The food, about the food, the PAPR food is costly and it's imported. It cannot be sterilized, it cannot be autoclaved, it cannot be E2O sterilized. And giving 3-4 food for each nurse or every team member is difficult. And but our food is E2O sterilizable. All members are protected. It's not that the operator has to be protected. The whole team has to be protected. Then only our cath lab is safe. So we are able to give to all the members. And it is 1/4 the cost of the imported food, and the design is evolving. See, our basic thing is COVID is 0.12 microns, and N95 filters up to 0.3 microns. That means 3 COVID viruses, if they are trying to rush to through a single pore, they will not come. But they behave and they line up, they will be able to enter. So, even whatever N95 mask you wear, there is a chance that you might get infected. But our system doesn't use the air inside the cath lab itself, inside the theater itself. We are getting air from somewhere else. I am operating on the third floor. The air comes from the ground floor, our basement, where there is no patient. So we get the best quality air with this, our TABT technique. This is how it looks like. Our PAPR is a bit bulky and we have a hood. Our hood is ETO sterilizable. Every time we get an ETO sterilized, but we name, because we don't change between the persons, so we name it. And it's ETO sterilized. You feel comfortable. Our surgeons started using it. They also feel comfortable. And most importantly, we have given an additional HEPA filter for all patients, all hoods, so that you feel additional safety. And an additional N95 mask gives you perfect safety, as well as it protects from contamination of operating field. And finally, how do we find that our cath lab is infected or not? We have got an idea. That is, we have used our air purifier, which is household air purifier. We have kept it in the corner of the cath lab and we started running it. It is not to purify air, but we hope that it will filter and the COVID, and COVID will be caught in this. So every third day we open up and take the filter and take a swab from that and send it for RT-PCR. RT-PCR is available in the hospital. So in case if it comes positive, then there's a chance that the cath lab is contaminated. So we can close down or for three or four days. This is how we try to do surveillance of our cath lab. And how do you clean up our cath lab in case if it's a contamination, known or unknown? We do a lot of asymptomatic patients. How do you know that your cath lab is missing? And how do you clean it? See, routine fumigation or double cleaning and all may not kill COVID. COVID is easily killed by ultraviolet light. Ultraviolet light of 200 to 250 nanometer kills COVID. That is what. So we have fixed 4 tube lights of this same power in the cath lab and as well as in the console room. So it will kill. We hope that it will destroy the aerosol COVID. And we have made a light like this with a 3 UV lights, and it has got a stand. We keep it in every corner of the cath lab after every night, so that even if once the aerosol settles, the surface COVID also will get destroyed. Thank you.
Madam, we are 20 minutes behind the schedule. You can conclude the session, I think. You can say, you can convey thanks to everyone. And we are 20 minutes behind the schedule. We have to start the live case transmission.
So you want us to wind up, Dr.?
Yeah, wind up. That would be better.
There are so many questions in our hearts, in our minds, and from but I can understand that. But a big thanks to all our worthy speakers who have actually done a great job. And I would like to thank Dr. Smith Srivastava, Professor Gurpreet Singh Wanda, and Dr. Keshav Murthy. All the talks were indeed great and brought an insight into COVID. And there are so many questions, but then I think we have the chat box where we can continue to discuss as asked by the organizers. So thanks a lot. It was indeed a great session, and hope the coming times are relatively less burdened with COVID. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.